JSW Cement has laid out a blueprint for its expansion plans, and also along with that, in a positive development, the subsidiary Sobha Cement has emerged as a preferred bidder for new mine block. To know about this and more, we've been joined by the Managing Director of JSW Cement, Mr. Parth Jindal. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Talk us about the expansion plan that you have for 25 million ton for 23 for that matter. How do you plan to achieve that, and what happens to the existing expansion plan that was intend to become a 20 million ton capacity by 2020 for that matter?
So currently, where we stand today, JSW Cement is a 14 million ton cement company, and our stated target was to become a 20 million ton cement company by 2020. Given the economic situation and given the slowdown that we have all witnessed over the last 6 months, those plans have been pushed by about 12 months. So JSW Cement is now going to become a 20 million ton cement company by 2021. Having said that, in a very positive development, as you rightly put it, JSW Cement and our subsidiary Shiva Cement has emerged as a preferred bidder for a very large limestone mine, which is adjacent to the existing Shiva Cement mine. With that, our entire limestone reserves in the east, in the eastern part of India, goes to about 100 million tons. So now we are commencing our project of putting up a million ton clinkerizing unit and a million ton grinding unit at Shiva Cement. With that, security of clinker, we are able to now further expand. So that is why our targets of 20 million, we are revising upwards to 25 million. And we would hope to achieve that by end of calendar year 2022. That is the targets for the company.
Okay, the last time we spoke, you said that you'd like to be a 20 million ton company before you go for an IPO. And like you said, that the plan has been now delayed by a year. By virtue of that, we're now looking at an IPO timeline of around what for that matter?
So we would be looking, so even our IPO plans would get pushed out by about 12 months. So earlier we were looking to come into the market in December of 2020. We were looking to do our listing by then. Now we would be looking at doing our listing by December 2021. So it's about a 12-month delay. And the metric for us is still 20 million tons. Although we have revised our targets upwards to 25 million tons, we would like to give that upside to the investor community and to all the people who subscribe to our shares that the company has very clear visibility to go to 25 million tons in a very short time period, which would give increased earnings to the company. So that is why for us the IPO has been delayed by 12 months. So we were very much on track till about 6 months ago, and then we've had to put a lot of our projects on hold
Right.
Because of the economic climate.
Right. So let me just ask you, if apart from the economic climate, and you said liquidity crunch, there has been delay in the payment system overall. Which region typically has led to this revision of the expansion plans? Because we know for a matter of fact that South has been struggling now. We had earlier part of the day, we had India Cements chief who said that the capacity demand is around 31 lakh ton per month, which has come down to 15 lakh ton per month. So that's the kind of suppression that we're looking at in terms of demand. Has that led to the alteration of these plans?
No, I think, see, this, if you look at the South Indian scenario, there's about 170 million tons of cement capacity in the South, and demand is only about 70 million tons. So there is a huge overhang of supply in the South. When I look at JSW Cement, our strategy of expansion in the South is more geared towards GGBS, which is ground granulated blast furnace slag, which is basically used in order to replace OPC in the concrete industry. It's an environmental friendly product, and it also acts as a performance enhancer to normal cement. And that is the reason why we are expanding in the South. The bulk of our expansion out of the 11 million tons close to 9 million tons. We are going to be adding in the west and in the east,
yeah.
about 2.5 million tons in the west and about 6 million tons in the east. And those two geographies are still doing relatively much, much better than the south. The demand supply scenario in the west is very, very good. The demand supply scenario in the east is also relatively stable. So that is why we are doing that.
Okay. All right. Talk about the debt to EBITDA performance of the company, because I wanted to understand that we had a specific targets coming in before the IPO could take place. Right now, what's the net debt to EBITDA and how much do you expect to improve it by 2021 for that matter?
So currently, last year, we ended the financial year at a debt to EBITDA of about 5:1, which was extremely high. Very highly levered. This year, by the end of this year, we would be ending at a debt to EBITDA of about 3.75 times.
Okay.
And our target is to be below 3:1 by the time we hit the markets in 2021.
Fair enough. You also spoke about inorganic capacity expansion. So I wanted to understand the change in your stance, because the last time we spoke to you, you said that you were just going to be looking at just the organic route expansion and not the inorganic one. So what has led to change of this? If you can throw some names, if that's difficult, then what's the kind of region that you're looking at in that case?
No, so I, you know, what I wanted to highlight was that the entire expansion plan that I've charted out is only on the organic side.
Right.
Now, if an inorganic opportunity that fits our requirements comes into the market and it's available, we would be very keen on looking at it. There are a lot of names and a lot of speculation going around Emami Cement. There are a lot of chatter that, you know, that is going to, that's on the block.
So we have bid for it.
No, we have not bid for it. We looked at it. We studied it very, very closely. What we realized with Emami Cement was that there are their assets are overlapping with ours. They have a clinkerizing unit in Baloda Bazar in Chhattisgarh. And then they have a grinding unit in Odisha, very close to our existing grinding unit.
Right.
They have a grinding unit in Bengal, very close to our existing grinding unit. So it was a overlap in terms of the asset footprint. So that is why we decided not to look at it or not to bid aggressively for it. You know, there are several companies vying for it because they do have a very good geographical presence.
Right.
There are others also. You know, there's talk about assets available in the west of the country as well. For us, we are very clear that we would be very keen on looking at assets in the central and in the western part of the country. So as of now, you know, nothing has really come up which has excited us or which really fits into what we in our current state can really afford. But you know, if anything does come up, we would definitely look at it, because you know, it would give us that help us achieving a increased output at a much faster time period than what I have outlined in our plans.
Great. Talk about Shiva Cements, because obviously that's one listed entity and we'd like to know more about it. You have more than 50% stake in the counter. The stock hasn't typically done too well. Financials are not looking that pretty. So what do you intend to do to turn around the financial situation of the company?
I think, you know, when we acquired Shiva Cement in 2017, we were very clear that the only reason we were acquiring this company was for the limestone deposits
right.
that the company owns.
Right.
You know, if you look at the existing capacities, you know, 0.15 million tons of clinker, 0.2 million tons of grinding capacity, it's an extremely small setup.
Right.
And, you know, we have done whatever we can do in order to improve the performance of the erstwhile units. But the future of this company has always been in terms of putting up a larger project, putting up a clinkerizing unit, putting up a grinding unit, and really, you know, putting up a very modern state-of-the-art facility. It's taken us 2.5 years, primarily, you know, in order to secure the land, both at the plant as well as in the mines. We've also been able to get all the environmental approvals in this period of time. We have the EC, we have the consent to establish everything already with us. So now, you know, after all this time, we've finally going to be commencing on an 800 crore investment into Shiva Cement. So it's a very exciting time. You know, we are very excited because Shiva Cement forms the bedrock of our strategy in the East.
Yeah.
The clinker that we require for our grinding units in Odisha and Bengal would be catered from Shiva Cement. So I think, you know, now that this project is coming live and it's actually, we're going to commence construction in April, I think once the project is commissioned, the company's performance will see a drastic improvement because it becomes it becomes a million ton fully integrated cement company, which is part of the larger JSW Cement growth story.
Sure. So if you're talking about the improvement in terms of the financials for even Shiva Cement, the kind of margin performance that we can expect in this 4 years of when the capex takes place, or for that matter, end of the 4 years when you've completely invested that 800 crore, what's the kind of ballpark figure you could provide?
No, I think if you look at the company, it's difficult for me to ascertain right now. But if you look at any financials of a million ton company, you know, you should be anywhere, you know, making anywhere between 800 to 1,000 rupees a ton.
Right.
So you know, that's the kind of performance that one can expect from this entity.
All right. Fair enough. I'm going to be talking more about the industry perspective right now. I do understand you have a different product mix, but you are essentially predominantly still based out of South, where we are seeing a lot of challenges in terms of the change in the government that has happened. We've seen a lot of re-examination of projects which have taken place, because of which the pricing power is depressed.
Yeah.
Especially that in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana.
Yeah.
When do you expect the demand revival to come in place for South? Because that's when the whole industry will start looking brighter.
I think you've hit the nail right on the head. I think the entire issue in the South has emanated from Andhra Pradesh. And it's because the slew of infrastructure projects that were going on till you know, May of this year have suddenly all stopped. Add to that, what compounded the poor demand scenario was the torrential rainfall that several states witnessed, whether it was Kerala, whether it was Karnataka, parts of Maharashtra, have seen tremendous amount of flooding and rainfall. So that all, you know, has culminated in a very low demand situation in the South. What's happened in Andhra Pradesh specifically is what is resulting in a low price environment today, because you have all these companies, all these factories in Andhra Pradesh, where there is no demand, pushing material into other states.
Right.
Like us, JSW Cement, our mother plant in Nandyal is in Andhra Pradesh, and I was just there yesterday, and it's a 5 million ton cement plant, and there's just no demand from Andhra Pradesh. So we are pushing material into Kerala, we're pushing material into Tamil Nadu, we're pushing material into Telangana, and that's causing prices to drop. So the entire demand supply situation, even though it was poor in the South, this has accentuated that.
Right.
So, you know, I've had a slew of meetings with the government in Andhra Pradesh as well, just trying to understand when do they think that things will revive. I think, you know, any new government takes time to settle in, and also takes time to understand the financial situation of the state. I think a lot of hard work has happened there, and I'm very confident that, and this is what my conversations with the government have yielded, that post Pongal, post you know, 15th of January, is when major infrastructure projects of the state will recommence.
Okay.
And that's when we can expect demand in AP to revive, and as a result, pricing power in the South to revive.
Okay, I'm not trying to draw any comparisons here. We know a lot of uncertainties which have happened in Maharashtra, and looking at the change of the government. Do you think pricing power could take a hit for Western region as a whole because of the situation?
No, I you know, I don't think so. I'm extremely positive about the West. I'm extremely positive about Maharashtra. You know, whether it's you know, whichever government comes, I think the infrastructure push that that Maharashtra has seen over the last 5 years is only going to continue. I think you know, when you look at our facility which is located just outside of Mumbai, you know, we are catering to all the major infrastructure projects in Mumbai, whether it's the coastal road or the Mumbai metro, or whether it's the new airport that is coming up, whether it's the missing link corridor, or whether it's the Worli Bandra and Warsaw Sea Link that is being extended. I think, you know, there's a lot of infrastructure projects that are going to come up, and Maharashtra being, you know, probably the most important state in the country, being the financial capital, I think any government that comes will only build and grow the infrastructure. And you know, Shiv Sena, which was part of the old government, they are continuing. So it's not that it is a fresh and a complete reset. Aditya Thackeray, who's been very involved with all the major projects in Mumbai, very involved with the BMC, you know, heard him on YouTube and heard him on the news a lot, talking very much about the requirements of a city like Mumbai. So I think it's going to be a very positive direction, whichever government comes, and I see no reason why to fear the change in government. I think, you know, any change will take some time to settle down, but whoever comes in a state like Maharashtra, I don't see any dip in demand.
All right, we'll leave it at that. Thank you so much for taking out the time and talking to Bloomberg.
Thank you.